Hello, everyone. This is not really a technical talk, but more a story about XCP-ng projects. Somehow a bit like, you know, the on-cloud and X-cloud talk this morning. So the title, well, the subtitle, is Building an Open Source and Turnkey Virtualization Platform. But first, about me. My name is Oliver. I'm the CEO and co-founder of a company called Vates, based in France, in Grenoble. I'd like to say I'm a former sysadmin, because maybe I have, let's say, 5-10% of my time now to do system administration tasks. But anyway, I work with Xen since 2007 or something like that. I created two projects, Xen Orchestra and XCP-ng. We'll talk about those two projects. You can find us and me on Twitter, and got the XCP-ng website just right there. Okay, so before going a bit inside the story of XCP-ng, let me remind you a bit some stuff. So as you've just seen before, it's building an open source and turnkey virtualization platform. So let's dissect a bit. So virtualization platform. So what does it mean exactly? Basically, a virtualization platform is not just the hypervisor. There is a hypervisor. It's Xen, so doing the compute part. There is a network stack. It's using Open vSwitch. There is a storage stack. This is something, let's say, specific to XenServer XCP-ng. It's called SMAPI. And you got an API to make all the call that you want to that platform. All of that is XCP-ng. Okay. So plus that, I'd like to say a virtualization platform needs something to easily administrate this platform. So you can add on top of that using the API, which is Xen Orchestra. So it's a web solution to manage backup and do a lot of stuff with XCP-ng, and it's also fully open source. The other word is turnkey. So what does turnkey mean? Because this is a word that you heard a lot of time, but in short, XCP-ng is, you can see, as a distro, if you like any other Linux distro, Ubuntu, Debian, whatever. It's, you just download the ISO, and you use it on a stick, and you install it on your server, and everything is working. So you don't, you know, go from a Debian or a CentOS and transform it into an XCP-ng. This is already something that's turnkey. Also, the other thing that's why it's called turnkey is that you are going, every call is going through an API. So it's a bit different in the way that even, let's say, network creation or anything related to storage is going through the API. So it's really a single block that you can call to make everything that you want for a virtualization platform. And finally, about the open source words, everyone here knows what's open source, but I wanted to explain more what I really call open source, because some companies sometimes are telling they are doing open source products, like you heard about, you know, on cloud before, but just pushing the code on a repository isn't making, for me, open source. Open source is more than that. It's not the license, but having a nice community, people that are, you know, participating to the project, but not just for the code. Could be documentation, could be testing, could be a lot of different stuff. So you don't need to be a developer to contribute to a project. And this is what we want to achieve with XCP-ng. Also, the last point is that even the documentation can be updated by anyone, like a wiki, for example, for XCP-ng. Anyone without any permission can update the wiki. So if someone is coming to you and telling, well, it's not documented, then you can say, can you please update the documentation, et cetera, et cetera. And documentation could be not just for, you know, let's say, use the product. It could be also for just, you know, improve the way it's built, et cetera, et cetera. So those are the objectives of XCP-ng. So to give you a quick glimpse, because people, I think, know what's a virtualization platform. You got the VMware stuff, you got Proxmox, you got Overt. But this is one screenshot of the one XCP-ng infrastructure managed by Xen Orchestra. So you can represent the idea of what it is. So it's nothing really new. I mean, you already seen that kind of graph and stuff. let's go back in history about Xen, because a lot of people know about KVM, etc. But Xen has a really long and complicated history. So it's not a new project, Xen itself, the hypervisor. It was created in 2003. And it was the first really open source hypervisor. And as you may know, it was the company making Xen was acquired by Citrix in 2007. And Citrix decided to create a turnkey product called XenServer at the time. So XenServer, when it started, was closed source. And as you may know also, Citrix is really focused on desktop virtualization, because this is what Citrix is doing. It's a remote desktop and kind of stuff. So basically, they acquired Xen to make a product for their customers, which were mainly Windows shop, and to be able to have virtual desktop VMs running, and so people can access remotely to Xen. So for Citrix, server virtualization wasn't in the center of their strategy. So it explained a lot of stuff. And in the meantime, 1 year later, you got XCP 1.0. XCP is Xen Cloud Project, and it was like the open source thing of Xen Server. Okay. And sadly, Citrix lacked a bit of the open source culture, so they just drop the source code somewhere, and that's it. And they didn't, you know, help people to contribute or make a good documentation to build it, et cetera, et cetera. So somehow, it was used by some people, but without gaining traction. Okay. And 2 years later, Citrix decided to open source Xen Server. So in the meantime, then XCP doesn't have any goal anymore, so they, you know, just remove XCP, which is logical if Xen Server is open source. But the problem is they continue to make it open source, you know, without having anyone contributing to it, and just having a small or reasonably small community of users only. And recently, and this was the starting point of XCP-ng, they decided to, let's say, kill the free edition, which is called free by Citrix, but which was, let's say, 80% of something open source inside it. And they decided to say, we will stop to do that. We will remove some features from free edition and put them into a paid edition. So then just, let's say, 1 month later, XenServer was forked, and XCP-ng is born, and XCP-ng means that's XCP, but new generation. So you know the context. So why forking a virtualization platform in 2018? I mean, you know, Xen is old. The trend is everything into the public cloud and containers, Kubernetes, et cetera, et cetera. So even myself, I said, well, I mean, I need that platform for my own production, but maybe I'm the only one in the world, you know? So I don't know if it will work, if people will be interested to have something like that. But we decided to do that for a lot of reasons. And the first one is that Xen Server will have a closed source future. It's not just removing some features from the free edition, but all the new features will be closed source. As I said, no developer community. They didn't really focus on their own user community, because server virtualization, again, was the Citrix central strategy. Not any open source culture in this company. And also some repo. For example, you have an open source tool inside Xen Server, but sadly, they just release the tarball when you have a release. So if you want to contribute before that, you just have to wait for the tarball, the source RPMs, when it's released, and you don't have access to the repo. So it's really, really hard to contribute. So this causes a lot of issues if you want to help the project. So it means there's a lot of stuff that could be improved, and also no build instructions. So you have a lot of source RPMs, and that's pretty much it. For us, I mean, for the company I founded, we also spotted some opportunities to do that. It could help to have more people using Xen, and so more people using Xen Orchestra, which the open source product we are selling. It's a subscription with support, etc. We could finally help people having issues. To give you an idea, half of our professional support tickets That's, we are selling a solution for that. Half of those tickets were reported having a problem, user reporting problems on ZenServer itself. So we couldn't help those users. You know, you are the backup product, for example, but it doesn't work because there is a bug in ZenServer. And the only answer that you can give is, please see with Citrix. We can't do anything about that. And that's not really good, you know? And now, by forking that, we are able to even fix problems upstream because we are learning how it works, et cetera, and even having a solution with our own platform plus the solution on top. So it even makes sense in a business sense. It's open source, but there is also, we're a company, and you know we are hiring developers, so we need to think about the business. So it was completely aligned to make that fork, both for the open source reasons and business reasons. But forking is not easy. You know, it's when you develop everything from scratch, like for example for own cloud to go to next cloud, okay, it's cloning and changing some logos, etc., but you mastered the software. Here it's a bit different. Historically, we were a web shop. Zenorchestra is a web solution, okay? So now you have this. And this, there's a lot of stuff. There is a full API made in OCaml, so you have to find people able to develop in OCaml, so that's not really common. You have to understand what's happening in Xen itself, what's happening in the Linux platform, because Xen, when you start Xen, it's the first thing booting on your host, and then it passes a lot of IOPS, network, etc., to DOM0, which is a privileged Linux VM here running in CentOS. And then you have to understand how it works, all component works. So it's just not getting something and rebadge it and redistribute it. You have to understand how it works, and this is not easy. So we didn't take that as an easy challenge. And there are a lot of challenges. The first one, and if you are doing a fork, you need to have enough people behind you and companies behind you. So we could use a Kickstarter, for example. We need to get more and more people, for example, in a forum to get them interested about the project. You need to have contributions, not just from your company, but from everywhere, ideally, to really get this challenge. Also on the technical side, you need, as I said just before, to be able to fork, to understand, to fix problems, to fix bugs, to add new features, because if you don't do that, nobody will think that you are able to maintain the product. So you have also to get the credibility by doing that. Also, to get all those challenges you need on the project level to get an open governance and a durability. So this is also what this morning talk was about, is maybe having the project into a foundation to be sure we won't do the same thing that Citrix for the people perspective. So if it's in the foundation, we are not the only company behind it, so the project can outlive us, et cetera, et cetera. So these are all the challenges. So did it work? It could have failed, but it didn't. So we started with a Kickstarter and telling people, okay, we'll do a first objective, which is reasonable, €6,000 to make just a prototype. And then if we are going better than that, we will try to work faster, having more people embed into the project, et cetera, et cetera. This was also a great way to see if people were interested about the project, because you can't really know before. And the great thing about Kickstarter, that if people are putting money in the project, you know that those people are really interested. It's not just telling, well, maybe I'm interested. They are helping the project. And it worked. In less than 24 hours, we reached the objective, and we ended to have even more than this amount because even some company couldn't pay via Kickstarter, so they sent checks and that kind of stuff to help us. We were around, let's say, 70K, something like that. So that was great because it helped us to get our first hire on someone able to create the first prototype. Some dates. So we were able to make our first release pretty quickly because the Kickstarter ended in February. So that was pretty fast. I got the opportunity to get someone, a contributor from Majaya, which is an RPM-based distro. So he helped us to create the release. And then we followed closely with the Citrix XenServer release, you know. So as soon as Citrix released the new version, we were able to keep up the pace. But not only keeping up, it was also adding new features, sign RPMs, because XenServer got a very strange update system, and we just relied on Yum, which is easier. We added more and more features to use just some features, for example, ZSTD compression support. Well, we'll talk about that later. We got a really nice Koji build platform, which is used by Fedora, I think. Mirror Bits, it's a project done by VLC guys, helping us to have mirrors all around the world and contributors telling, OK, I can host your RPMs, your ISO, and we will air-sync each other. And then when you want to fetch the file, automatically Mirror Bits will redirect you to the closer location. And now, just yesterday, we released the XCP-ng 8.0 beta in beta so far, because we are doing a lot of tests and a lot of great stuff. So today, I just updated the numbers, but we got a lot of people contributing. So in terms of community success, it was great because we got a lot of active contributors. But what I mean by active, I mean people with at least one post. Okay, so we've got a lot more people registered, but there is some people just reading, etc. But people actively participating, there's a lot. We've got a lot of unique downloads, unique per IP address. And the success is also because it's really easy to upgrade. So the first target, if you like, was people using XenServer. Because the transition from XenServer to XCP-ng is really, really simple. It's like updating XenServer. It does the same thing. You can even live migrate from XenServer to XCP-ng platform. It will work, even in live. So for people using XenServer, I just want to have server virtualization. So that's a good alternative. We also member of the Zen Security pre-disclosure list, which is a closed list helping people to know the latest problem that you could have with, for example, Intel CPUs. And this is really helping because we could provide patches really fast as soon as it's public. So this is a nice place to be. There is AWS, et cetera, there. We are also working to be inside an open source foundation, and in particular the Linux Foundation, because they're already hosting Xen projects. So that could be really interesting to have also a distro based on Xen inside the Linux Foundation. So we just have a proposal there, so we're working on it. This is, for me, really important to tell people that we don't want to make like Citrix did in the past. And also, we are working closer to the upstream. By that, I mean our developers are trying to, everything we are doing is on GitHub, and we're trying to push it, for example, some fixes for Xen or whatever. We are pushing that upstream because we know this is how it should be done. And again, unlike Citrix, there is no license and no feature restrictions. So our business model is pretty simple. It's support-based only. This, as you heard this morning, this is a nice model that is working, which is fair, which is not the best one in the short term. But for me, this is how open source should be done. So regarding the technical challenge, in fact, we fixed a lot of bugs in the upstream, even in XenServer itself. We got a testing repo, which is really great, because, for example, XenServer doesn't have a beta version, so we have, so we can, you know, tell people just try it, like for the beta we just have yesterday. So they are testing it, validate it, and giving us also ideas, etc. Regarding ZSTD, we added that last year, and this is really interesting because when you are making a backup, for example, with Xen Orchestra, if you don't use compression, then you will end with big file, but it will be faster in time than using JZIP, because JZIP is really, really slow, mono-threaded, etc. And so we decided to add ZSTD, which is a compression library from Facebook. And by doing that, we basically cut the backup time a lot, even comparing to the fastest one before, and to end with a file that's even, as you can see here, smaller than using JZIP. So it's a win-win on all stuff. And this was maybe, let's say, two or 3 weeks of development. So as you can see, it wasn't a big deal to do that, but the gains were really, really important. So what's next? We are growing. So as you may imagine, it's harder to find people working in system, in Xen, in the kernel, et cetera, than finding web developers. So we are growing, and the main blocker, I would say, is to find the right people. But the team is already at half of the objective for this year, so we are great. We're working with labs because I discovered that by talking with some labs in France, some university and labs working with universities. They're working a lot on Xen and doing a lot of tests on Xen, so it's really interesting to work with them. Sadly, I didn't know that because researchers are working on something, even pushing the code on GitHub, but when it's done, they just make the publication and they never try to make it upstream because when the publication is done, it's done. So we came there to those universities and said, okay, so those great work, for example, working on scheduler, we can help to make your work upstream. And this might be really interesting to get innovation right there into the hypervisor, for example, with working with those talented people. It's also a joint effort. So we are working with multiple companies because, let's say, in our community, we got a large part of people playing, you know, with their home lab. But on the other side, we got some companies with reasonable size infrastructure. So we are working with them to get what do you need that you don't have, or you don't had in XenServer or your existing virtualization platform. What could we do? Can we, for example, improve something very specific, for example, the scheduler in Xen, to adapt to your workload, that kind of stuff. So this is something that's a bit unique that you can offer to a company, even a big one. In terms of research and development, so we managed to learn that there is a lot of stuff that could be done because we are coming from the outside, you know. So a lot of people are really busy with the security stuff, and I understand that, but we are coming with another view. So yes, security is really important, but there is low-hanging fruits that we could, you know, develop to improve the whole platform. So to give you some example, maybe you heard about IO Euring, which is a new structure that could be used inside the latest Linux kernel that's really faster than asynchronous IO, AIO. So we are working on a proof of concept to show that maybe we could raise the number of IOPS of all your VMs with something that might take maybe 1 month or so. So that's a low-hanging fruit, in my opinion. Adding on the network side of VXLine support, so we're already working on that, and it works well. Having tunnels between VMs created really easily, that kind of stuff. You already have open vSwitch inside your DOM0, inside your VM, but not all the features are exposed through the API. So we had to make the glue and to expose that, for example, in Xen Orchestra. So again, it's not rocket science, but it could improve a lot the final turnkey thing. In compute, it's more like rocket science, believe me. You can work on the scheduler, NUMA optimizations, because you know there is more and more cores with cache, etc. So VM placements on the hardware, on the CPU, could be really, really important. For example, on AMD CPU, you get a lot of cache, you get a lot of cores, and you got what's called an infinity fabric in the middle. So if you have to go through there, it will be slower than if you access the cache locally. So that could improve drastically, something like 30%, maybe 40% of your load if you have a cache locality. And something that's really interesting is called core scheduling, which will lead to sync scheduling that could be able to bypass all the Intel security problems. Because for now, you probably have to disable hyper-threading if you don't have trusted guests. But with solution coming, so Xen people are working on that, but we have the ability to help them and to provide, you know, our view, maybe review some stuff. That might be a solution to overcome this problem and even having more performances in the end. And obviously, all of that working with academics for the majority of the topics. So there is publication with benchmarks, etc. And that could be even helpful for other open source projects because we are talking a lot with, for example, KVM or other people from other projects to find a solution about, for example, security issues. A quick example is using Optane Drive. Maybe you know those drives. They are 3D XPoint. Memory from Intel. Those drives are really, really, really fast. But sadly, the storage stack on the platform is what we could call legacy, you know, because it was built when you have spinning hard drive, so latency wasn't that important. But using that kind of legacy stack on those drives could reduce the hardware performances a lot. Because, in fact, the CPU can't keep up about the cycles compared to the disks. So this kind of disk, to improve that, you need to use, for example, SPDK, which is an Intel thing, delegating the IOPS in the user space. So this is one solution. And the other one is, I told you before, IOU ring, which be able using two rings, both one in user space, one in the kernel space, to be able to write faster and maybe use those one at their full speed, which isn't the case right now. So part of this talk was edited because I did it at the first demo, but since then we finally finished some stuff, so there is improvement also on the platform itself. For example, mirrors, I told you that. Compression for even migration. There is a lot of stuff that can be improved, so now the thing is to prioritize to find exactly which part we have to improve. Basically, my algorithm is to find the best one with the least work needed to do it. And this is, in general, a good approach because you can really, you know, unlock some previous problems by just spending maybe 1 month or two on just thinking on how to do that better, and that's it. So in ZenOrchestra side, since we have now the management backup platform and the virtualization platform, we can combine that. So you've seen the result with ZSTD compression for backup, but this is just one example on how now you master the whole stack, that you can do a lot of interesting stuff. So we want to continue to integrate those two software to really give an experience to people that's having a virtualization platform is easy. Because my point of view is that there is a lot of great open source projects, but in general, the hard part is to take them all at one place, one thing, to make them working. And in general, making the glue around all the tools is what's taking a lot of time. So one of our goals is to provide this glue, to provide this turnkey thing that's still open source. You can do whatever you want to do with it. And pour innovation in that the whole stack to have a coherent thing. So I said that because the potential is great, and somehow people forgot that their load have to run somewhere. Because, you know, especially developers, because there's a cloud everywhere, serverless and whatever. But somehow your load has to run on someone's server. That could be your own or in the public cloud or private. It doesn't matter. But still, almost everyone forgot that you can improve that. And finally, there's not a lot of people and a lot of company investing massively inside improving those performances. There is a huge non-open source people. There is Red Hat with KVM. But you know, for the whole stack, there is still a lot of work to do to improve it, and could be multiple factors better just by, you know, working on it and trying to find a sweet spot between, you know, security and performances and that kind of stuff. So how could you help on this project? We got a really nice community. We have both got a forum, and we are on a free node on IRC. We are hiring because, as I said, it's hard to find people with good experience or at least basic experience in systems and kernels and Zen, even another hypervisor. We are working also doing not joint venture but more partnership with other company in Europe, because there is public funding if you gather as multiple companies to make research and development projects at the European scale. So that could be interesting if, for example, you have, let's say, on your platform. I will give you an example. We are working with a university in Grenoble, which is working on medical stuff, how to say that, imagery. Let's say if you pass a scan or any something like that, we got an image of the scan, and it's up to the doc to find where is the problem or if there is any problem. So they are working with deep learning to find those potential problem, but this load has to run on something, you know? And they don't want to run this into a public cloud because it's personal data, medical data. So they will run that inside a data center with people they know, but also they want to optimize the load for that. So on the developer side, it doesn't matter how it works if they are using Docker or not, but then from the platform side, we are seeing a load and we can help to modify Xen or modify the platform to perform to get the best performances for this kind of load, because there is some patterns. You know, if you repeat some kind of load, you can detect that it's using that kind of cores or more memory, etc. So you can incrementally update the platform to improve the load for this kind of problems. So this is just an example, but this is the kind of stuff that we are working on. Also, if you just want to test XCP-ng on your hardware, that might be fine, because we are not a large company. Vates is now 15 people, so it's not big. We can't buy all the servers on the market to make tests, so if you want to test on your hardware, that could be helpful. And if you want to contact us, ISED, IRC, or whatever, we got an email contact, so if you want to maybe host an ISO or IPMs, you can do that. Okay, so if you have question, go ahead. Feel free.
Any questions?
You had with the compression, there was a comparison between GZIP and
ZSTV.
Yeah. What were the reasons the data to choose for that one? Because you have also other compression compression programs.
Yeah. There's no universal thing. Basically, it's let me try to rephrase the question to be sure I understand it. So the test we did. Did we choose a specific data set for this test, or we just try to compress random data? Is that your question?
Well,
the compression algorithm is ZSTD. It's a compression algorithm made by Facebook. So you just type ZSTD on Google, and you'll find the details. So,
but is there a specific reason for choosing that program over some others?
Why using ZSTD instead of others? Okay, that's basically because we did a benchmark with LZ4 and a lot of them. I can't even remember all the one we tested, but for our load, ZSTD was the best one, and I think close behind was LZ4, something like that, maybe 10% behind. But regarding CPU versus size, it was the best one. And on the ZSTD Google, if you Google it, you will find it on the webpage of ZSTD project. They are comparing directly against maybe 5 or 6 other formats. And in general, ZSTD is better than the other. So it's open source, it's not that big, and it works well. So that's why we choose this one against, let's say, LZ4 or whatever. And it supports multiple threads. This is the most important thing against JZIP, because any other compression algorithm was better than JZIP anyway. But then ZSTD was even better than the other one, so that's why we chose this one. Okay. Any other question? No? Yes?
Say something about what kind do you know of any advantages or disadvantages compared to other environments?
You mean about XCP-ng?
Yeah.
Advantages? Well, I would say the turnkey part is, if you compare it to other, let's say, comparable solution, the turnkey part is, I think, really important. Because as a user, you don't have to build it yourself. You know, you need to install your distro, then you need to install your hypervisor, and then your all the components needed to work with, for example, network, open vSwitch, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So the fact it's turnkey is, for me, a great advantage against other open source equivalent projects. But if you compare to, let's say, VMware is turnkey, but VMware is really expensive, and it's not just a cost thing, but it's also the fact that you are choosing this way open source versus closed source. And lastly, against the cloud, we are not targeting companies. I mean targeting because in the business way it's to selling support, you know. We aren't targeting companies which already or want to go for the whole IT into the cloud, because those companies made the choice to maybe they know the risk or they don't know, whatever, but they made this choice. Our brand, I would say, would be to say just know what you are doing with your IT, because it's open source. You can run it on your hardware or your, let's say, a partner with a data center, and you keep track. Because if you have your own server and running VMware, then you have to trust VMware about it. And if you are running on your server with something open source, KVM, whatever, or XCP-ng, this is good. So the answer is it depends against what. I would say against closed source, it's because it's open source. And against open source, it's because it's turnkey. So this is roughly the answer to your question.
Any other questions?
Thank you.